Hello and welcome to Perspectives, the weekly edition. I'm Sebastian Gomes. It's been 4 years, wow, 4 years since Pope Francis was elected following the historic resignation of Pope Benedict XVI. And what an extraordinary 4 years it's been. If there's one word to describe Francis that everyone can agree on, it's reformer. And the facts back it up. Since being elected, Francis has created a council of 9 cardinals representing the different continents to advise him on restructuring the Vatican bureaucracy. He's created a commission to study and realign the Vatican's financial arm with gospel principles and transparency. He created a commission for the protection of minors to recommend strategies and institutionalize best practices. He revised the annulment process, making it simpler and less expensive. He stressed servant leadership among the church's bishops and reoriented her pastoral ministry toward accompaniment and integration. Not to mention the paradigm shift in tone and focus on the marginalized that's given a new credibility to the church's social and moral voice. Well, what does all of that reform really mean? Can we put Francis's clarion call to conversion in historical context? And where is it all leading the church? Well, joining me today to shed some light on church reform under Francis is Christopher Bellitto. He's a professor of history at Kane University in New Jersey. He's a Catholic commentator and author of several books, including Renewing Christianity, A History of Church Reform from Day One to Vatican II, and 101 Questions and Answers on Popes and the Papacy. His most recent book is Ageless Wisdom, Lifetime Lessons from the Bible, which will be featured on our book show Subject Matters this spring. So be sure to tune in to that. Chris, it's great to have you here with us at Salt and Light.
Thanks for having me.
Now, I just said that most people think about Francis as primarily a reformer. Do you?
I do. I think that it is the, to use the 20-buck term, it's the hermeneutic of his papacy. It's the pair of glasses that he wears to see the world and the way that he wants the world to see the church. Because there's a great deal of credibility behind reform when you say, I need to be reformed, it means that you're saying something's deformed. Something needs to be fixed. And there's a great phrase in church history, the Latin is ecclesia semper reformanda. The church is always reforming, always in the process of being reformed. And one of the great insights, I think, of Vatican II, there was a Dominican theologian by the name of Yves Congar, who knew his history well. And when asked, of all the teachings of Vatican II, what was the most important? He said, the church reclaimed her identity as a pilgrim. And in the Middle Ages, people say this, they said that, they would have used the Latin word viator. A viator is somebody on a via, on a way. You're not there when you're on the way. You right. have a plan, and sometimes you get knocked off.
Now, it seems that Francis's focus on reform steals the headlines, it gets people talking, people are immersed in this discussion of what he's doing and what's changing, and it seems new. But that's why when we had the chance to have you on, I said, we gotta do this, because when you look at church history, and you have to tell us this, that his reforming movements have sprung up many, many times in the past, right?
Sure, the only constant in church history is change. Now, doctrine doesn't change, that is, our core beliefs don't change, but the words we use to describe those doctrines, in fact, doesn't change. We don't get the creed until about 400 years after Jesus, 350 right. years. We don't use the word transubstantiation to describe the bread and wine becoming the body and blood of Jesus until the Middle Ages. That doesn't mean before the Middle Ages the bread and wine weren't transformed. So we're constantly refreshing ourselves. We're constantly getting better at our core. But for the first 50% of the church's life, we were only around for 2,000 years. Right. For the first 1,000 years, there really is no concept of institutional reform because there's not an institution as we think of it today. The very right. word papacy, papatus, appears almost nowhere before the year 1050. It's all about personal reform. So the key in all reforms is personal reform. And even Luther, who's seen as the reformer, for people who want to think that reform is a four-letter word, who may not like Luther, Luther's criticism was that all of this other stuff we're doing with relics and indulgences is taking away from our inner reform. Without inner reform, the Greek word metanoia, nothing happens.
And so why do you think it seems like so many new things are happening?
Nothing new is happening. I think what's happening is that we are finally coming into Vatican II's teachings. Because if you study any revolutions, the American Revolution, the French Revolution, you can go back through history, what happens is they swing one way, and then they swing in the opposite direction. Then they reach a synthesis point. For those of us who remember German philosophy, there was a guy named Hegel. And Hegel says there's a thesis, and then there's an antithesis, an antithesis, and then a synthesis. And that's why the papacy of Francis fits in so well. Francis was not a father of the council. Mm-hmm. He wasn't at the council, as Karol Wojtyła was, for four sessions as a bishop, or Joseph Ratzinger, Benedict XVI, as a theologian. Bergoglio was being formed as a Jesuit during the council, and so he was ordained after the council. He's a son of the council. Right. So he's not invested in the fights of, I said this and you said that. He's receiving it. So I think, I'm an historian, not a prophet, but I think that if we look at, that we will look back at Francis's papacy to the natural synthesis point where we kind of avoided these fights that we're having about Vatican II. He takes Vatican II for granted. He doesn't ask, you know, should we have done Vatican II? Could we have done it better? He takes it for granted, and that's what the canonization of John Paul II and John the 23rd were really about. He was canonizing Vatican II.
Yeah, that was a very interesting moment, and a lot of people were reading into that. You know, what does this mean? Because I know we knew that John Paul II's canonization was in process,
right.
But we know he waived the second miracle for John the 23rd. But that was a symbolic gesture, was it not?
Right. I mean, on one level, it was big church. You know, bring one wing together with the other wing. But I think that doesn't go far enough, because I really do think that it was the sense that this is a church of both ends and not either or. We live in a very bipolar world, right? And there's love and there's hate. There's no love and like, or hate and kind of not hate. And I think what Francis is trying to push us toward is a church where there's room for lots of different people and lots of people to disagree. This is really a papacy of process.
When you look at the history of the church, do you see a moment where, you know, a reform movement began or a reforming personality emerged that is similar to the context that we're in today?
Yeah.
Or is there something really unique about where we are today?
Well, I think what's really interesting is that if you look at the history of the church, some of the best reform movements come from the periphery. And one of the most famous is Francis of Assisi. We think of Francis, we take Francis out of time, right?
Yeah.
And we think he's the uber saint of all saints. When Francis shows up in Rome, they think he's nuts. They think he's one of these itinerant preachers,
right,
who was really pushing away the authority of the church. And we focus on Francis's poverty, but for Francis of Assisi, it was obedience. But Francis's movement of getting back to the gospel, getting back to the core, which was kind of a contrast to the very worldly papal monarchy of the 1200s, comes from the periphery, gets its energy in the center, Rome, and gets sent out again. In our own lifetimes, that was Mother Teresa, who brought the periphery in. Now we have a pope from a country that never gave us a pope before, in the same way that John Paul II's papacy energized the church. That was a papacy of the periphery. We tend to think of John Paul II, you know, at the end, the great John Paul II. When John Paul II first showed up, the energy of that first 5-7 years is like the energy of the first phase of the Francis papacy.
That's fascinating. We have to take a short break, but we'll be back with Christopher Bellitto talking about what's unique about Francis's reform and resistance to reform. Always an interesting topic. So don't go anywhere.
At Salt and Light Television, we're interested in your perspective. Share your thoughts with us through Twitter and Facebook, and watch more episodes of Perspectives, the weekly edition, on our website, saltandlighttv.org/perspectives.
In questo percorso risulta normale, anzi salutare, riscontrare delle difficoltà che nel caso della riforma si potrebbero presentare in diverse tipologie di resistenze. Le resistenze aperte, che nascono spesso dalla buona volontà e dal dialogo sincero. Le resistenze nascoste, che nascono dai cuori impauriti o impietriti, che si alimentano dalle parole vuote del gattopardismo spirituale, di chi a parole si dice pronto al cambiamento, ma vuole che tutto resti come prima. Esistono anche le resistenze malevole, che germogliano in menti distorte e si presentano quando il demonio ispira intenzioni cattive, spesso in veste di angeli. Quest'ultimo tipo di resistenza si nasconde dietro le parole giustificatrici e in tanti casi accusatorie, rifugiandosi nelle tradizioni, nelle apparenze, nelle formalità, nel conosciuto oppure nel voler portare tutto sul personale senza distinguere tra l'altro l'attore e l'azione. L'assenza di reazione è segno di morte, quindi le resistenze buone e perfino quelle meno buone sono necessarie e meritano di essere ascoltate, accolte e incoraggiate a esprimersi, perché è un segno che il corpo è vivo.
Welcome back. Today we're looking at reform in the church under Pope Francis. We're here with our guest, Christopher Bellitto, who's a professor of history at Kane University in New Jersey. And Chris, what we just saw there was a clip of Pope Francis addressing the Roman Curia just before Christmas 2016, which is an opportunity that he has taken every year to speak to the Curia specifically about reform. This was a very important address just a few months ago. But when you hear what he's saying, when you read what he's saying over the last 4 years, how do you interpret, you know, this message that he's giving to the bureaucracy there?
Well, it's pretty direct, and the headlines are, you know, Pope wags finger at Curia, which makes 99% of the church stand up and cheer. And of course, his enemies will say, look, he's wagging that finger. Well, John Paul II and Benedict XVI wagged a lot of fingers as well. Mm-hmm. But if you look at specifically the last two addresses around Christmas time, one was a couple of years ago where he diagnosed 10 or 12 diseases of the church, and this one was kind of more the antidote to the diseases. Mm-hmm. And he was being very clear in talking about the need for personal conversion, because personal conversion leads to credibility, it leads to authenticity. And if you do a study of church reform, what you find is you could put all the structures that you want into place top down, but if they're not invested, if people aren't invested in them, if it doesn't come out of their pores, if they're not involved in the process of that reform, the structural reform is absolutely useless and a waste of time. The three things you have to know about Francis are he's a Jesuit, he's a Jesuit, and he's a Jesuit. And I say that as somebody who's Jesuit trained. Discernment, I mean, literally the Latin word of discernment is to kind of tack your way through what Ignatius of Loyola talks about, feelings of consolation and desolation, and find that middle way, that moderate way. And this is really Francis's whole persona. You know, he is, I have called him a radical moderate. We live in such a divided world that being a moderate is now a radical position. And he's being hit by both sides, which probably means you're doing something right. Mm-hmm. And so what he's trying to do is he's trying to moderate the conversation in the church so that we don't fall into these camps. It is, in essence, a post-partisan attempt to get at what are we really about? And the bottom line, it's about internal conversion. So many of our viewers will have read The Imitation of Christ from the Middle Ages, or they're familiar with Teresa of Avila's Interior Castle. Or during Lent, or during Advent, it's part of the liturgical season, that if we are to be servant leaders, we need to go inside first and retouch that which is absolutely essential. And I think that this is one of the reasons why he reacts so strongly against rigid rules. Are people attracted to the faith because it's alive, or are people attracted to the faith because of Rule 4.9a?
Right.
We both know the answer to that. And so I think that's one of the reasons why he is such a breath of fresh air with all due respect to Benedict and with all due respect to the latter years of John Paul II. John Paul II's papacy was so long, you kind of have to take it in stages.
Right.
And the enthusiasm about John Paul II and the reverence that we have for this 27-year papacy, and we watched him die and suffer right before our eyes, and it was so painful to watch. You know, he broke a lot of rules when he came in as well, in the sense of he was being Pope in a different way. Where he's preaching the same gospel, but in the case of John Paul II, was using mass media in a way that hadn't been done before, just because of the age in which he lived, and the man was himself an extrovert. He knew how to use the camera. Francis is actually an interesting balance between those two. I think, and if you look at Paul VI, if I look at the last three papacies, and excluding the one-month papacy of John Paul I, there are a lot of ties between Paul VI and Francis. The further we get from Paul VI, the more we understand that this was a tragic papacy in the sense that he himself was not sure he should have been elected. John XXIII referred to him as Amleto mio, my Hamlet. And he was known as the Pope of Butts. He would say something that the progressives would like, but, and something that the conservatives would like.
Right.
So, yes, Francis feels fresh and he feels new, but he's also part and parcel of these papacies that came before.
I wanted to get back to the point you made about personal conversion. That strikes me. Every time he's talking about reform, he talks about conversion and personal conversion. And it makes me think two things. One, that makes the reform actually quite difficult.
Sure.
Because if it was just about recreating a structure or a system to impose on people, I'm not sure how much change could really happen. But the other thing that hit me is this is a man who has experienced conversion himself.
Right.
Do you get that? Like, I mean, you mentioned his Jesuitness, but if we look at his biography, he seems to have been a person who has been able to convert.
He was, by his own admission, a lousy administrator. He's made a Jesuit superior at the age of 36, which he said in Italian was bots, crazy. And he became very authoritarian.
Right.
And he said that was his style. And that's why he got this reputation for being conservative, even reactionary. And he says that was wrong, a wrong reading.
Right.
But he says that he was, in fact, authoritarian. His own Jesuit brothers rose up against him, basically got him tossed out from being provincial, and he went into this kind of period of exile where he really had to re-find his vocation and re-find his center.
Right.
Well, isn't the person who has been forgiven or has forgiven himself or herself more of an apostle of mercy? Because you can give that which you have received.
Received, right. Yeah, no, that's so true. The other thing that he talked about in his Christmas address was resistance.
Yeah.
And this is always very interesting when the Pope acknowledges and talks openly,
right,
about the kinds of the voices of resistance that he's up against. And he talked about three different kinds: open resistance, a hidden resistance, and a malicious resistance. And it hits you that this is a person who knows what people are saying around him, people who are very supportive of him, and also people who are,
right,
in the resistant camp. Who are the people who are resistant? Why can you resist the kind of reform that seems so, you know, commonsensical to a lot of Catholics?
Right,
that
and we should note that knowing what your enemies are saying, he's not doing that in any sort of paranoid or narcissistic way. You know, when you come up as a member of a religious order, specifically in his case Jesuit, but it could be others as well, decision making is done in a group way, in a collegial way. Synodality is the other way. Subsidiarity is another word, where you're making important decisions at the lowest level. How did he begin the Synod of October 2014? He said, "Let no one say, this can't be said."
Right.
Which was very different than the prior two papacies. And one of the really interesting examples of what I call Catholic chutzpah is the fact that people are criticizing Francis in a manner that if you had ever said anything like that about John Paul II or Benedict XVI, you could well literally be labeled a heretic and kind of been cast out. And so he's embracing that because I think he believes, having gone through lots of discernment and process, the more voices, the better. However, there comes a point where someone's got to call the play. He's not indecisive. When Jesuits do spiritual direction or do discernment between a superior, say, and someone who's deciding on his next assignment, the line that they use is, you discern, we discern, I decide. That is, the provincial decides.
Right.
So there is, you know, a person there who says, we're going to listen to everyone, but when I call the play, I'm calling the play because I'm Peter. Let's remember, I am Peter, we are bishops together. As Bishop of Rome, the Pope is a member of the College of Bishops at the same time that he is head of the College of Bishops. So we come together, we decide, not everybody is going to be happy about it. But what he really hates is clericalism. Hmm. We should never use the word hate. He hates clericalism.
Yeah,
and he talks about it as a disease,
yeah,
as a viper. And he even used this great, when he's talking about the curia and the bureaucracy or the priests who are coming up or seminarians. When I taught in a seminary, and we used to say there are very few vocations to the priesthood, but plenty of vocations to the episcopacy. They want to be bishops. The notion is that you are to be a servant leader. You want to lead by your own example, by your own credibility. And he used a phrase that was really sharp, a nest of mediocrity. Mm. Bureaucracies exist to exist. And that may be fine at the Department of Motor Vehicles, not really, but it's really bad in the Curia, which is the central administrative structure of the church, which is actually not very large at all. And so it's that careerism and that clericalism that he wants to get away from. And one of the best examples of that is, of course, Benedict's resignation, mm, where Benedict said the office is bigger than the person. The person is not the office.
Yeah.
And so it's the service that's being given, and he's trying to return. Now, why is there resistance to that? Well, there are people who I think are of an authoritarian bent, and they rely on a submission of will and obedience. What's interesting is that most authoritarian people want people to follow their authority, but some of them are not deferring to Peter's authority. Another
yeah,
example of Catholic chutzpah
yeah,
at work. But I sometimes wonder if there isn't a mistrust, a distrust, a lack of faith in part of some of the church leaders that we in the pews, laymen and laywomen, can deal with the messiness of life. I mean, I have to say, as a married person and as a father, with all due respect to my brothers and sisters who are in ministry, my life is not black and white. My life is gray and it's messy and it's ugly and it's a field hospital. Now the person at the top is telling me, don't try to make it black and white. Jesus is in there, mm-hmm, in that messiness. And I think that messiness is very subversive to people of an authoritarian bent, but creative to someone with the managerial perspective of Francis.
Fascinating. I want to show a clip here of someone we both know, Austin Ivory. He wrote a great book, a biography on
the
Francis.
The Great Reformer.
The Great Reformer. It's a wonderful book if you haven't read it. And here's Austin speaking to Catholic News Service about how he interprets the reforming zeal of Pope Francis. Take a look.
The more I've studied the Pope's life and looked at him, I realized that really he sees his mission as opening up spaces for the Holy Spirit to act. He's convinced that, you know, the Holy Spirit is in charge of the church, but it's sometimes blocked. It's blocked by the way we structure things or our own attitudes. So all this can be summed up, the whole papal reform, Francis's big vision for the church, can be summed up as, you know, freeing up the channels for the Holy Spirit to flow through the church so the church can better develop and serve and evangelize humanity.
Okay, that was Austin Ivory speaking there, believes that Francis is just trying to make channels for the Holy Spirit. Francis is clearly a man who believes in the Holy Spirit. Do you interpret it the same way?
Yeah, I think, you know, the Greeks have two words for time, chronos, which is time on our watch, and kairos, from which we get the word charisma. These moments where the Holy Spirit breaks through, the election of John the 23rd, the election of John Paul II, the election of Francis. And I think all of us who have fallen in love, who have witnessed the birth of children, know that in that kairos moment, you don't question it. You just go with it. And you try to cooperate as much as possible. And so I think we may really be living in a very graced moment in the life of the church. I speak to lots of parish audiences and meet people in their 60s and the 70s who thought that they had lost Vatican II, which had turned them on when they were in college, and now they find at the end of their lives that they're kind of getting Vatican II back. Now, I think that that's a little too cut and dry and a little too black and white, but nevertheless, I think we are at a particularly graced moment to really live this third generation of Vatican II.
Certainly. And finally, we're running out of time here, Chris, but I wanted to ask you if you could kind of summarize everything we've been talking about and try to explain to people what is really at the heart of Francis's vision for reform and for the church. How would you interpret it? How would you explain
One sentence.
It?
Reality is superior to ideas. It goes back to the visit in the Philippines where there was a girl, her name was Glizelle Palomar, and she had lived on the streets, and she was chosen to speak to the Pope and tell her story. Maybe she's 12, 14. She breaks down in tears. And Francis had a speech, and the speech was in English. Now, when he puts his speech down and switches to Spanish, you pay attention. He'd be a lousy poker player. That's his tell. And he said, Glizelle asked a question. How does God allow this to happen? The question has no answer except in her tears, and Christ weeps with us. And he said, reality is superior to ideas. And so when he meets someone, he wants to know, what's your reality? He's not going to ask, what category do you fit in? Did you fast for an hour before you received communion? Because quite frankly, I don't think he cares. And I think that's very refreshing to a lot of people who experience Catholicism as a list of rules. And I think he's trying to put the smile back in the joy of the gospel.
And it's a challenge to all of us.
It certainly is. It's a challenge of the gospel.
Incredible moment that we're living through. Thanks very much, Chris.
Thanks for having me.
Christopher Bellitto is a professor of history at Kane University in New Jersey. He's a Catholic commentator and the author of several books, including Renewing Christianity, A History of Church Reform from Day One to Vatican II. Be sure to check that out. His latest book, Ageless Wisdom, Lifetime Lessons from the Bible, will be featured on our book show Subject Matters this spring. You can find out more about Chris and his insightful work on his Google site. Just Google Christopher Bellitto and it will pop up. He's also on Twitter, at Dr. C. Bellitto. That's all the time we have for today, but thanks very much for joining us. For Deacon Pedro, I'm Sebastian Gomes. We'll see you again soon.